This conference will now be recorded.
ये वरना नेक्स्ट स्लाइड है उसको नेक्स्ट स्लाइड में मोमेंट में और ये बरवा पे स्लाइड हां ये और पूरा वॉइस कोड है
मैडम
यस सर
ओके मैडम ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಒಬ್ಬರು ಇದ್ದಾರೆ ಅಸಿಸ್ಟೆಂಟ್ ನೀವು ನೆಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ ಸ್ಲೈಡ್ ಹೇಳೋಣ ಅವರು ನೆಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ ಸ್ಲೈಡ್ ಗೆ ಮೂವ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಮಾಡ್ತಾರೆ ಮೇಡಂ
ಓಕೆ ಸರ್ ಓಕೆ
ಓಕೆ ಮೇಡಂ ಕ್ಯಾರಿ ಆನ್ ಮೇಡಂ ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು
ಓಕೆ ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು ಸರ್ I think students we saw this diagram so we'll see the drugs which inhibit protein synthesis they are aminoglycosides tetracyclines and macrolides these are the drugs next next slide
हेलो
हेलो यस सर
ओके टेल मैडम
प्लीज गो टू द नेक्स्ट स्लाइड
मैडम नेक्स्ट आक ಬಿಕ್ರಿ
हां नेक्स्ट सर हां ओके this classification we already seen so importantly the drugs are streptomycin so whenever we say streptomycin important use of this drug is we use this drug in the management of tuberculosis okay we'll see what are the important other drugs what are the other uses next slide okay now coming to the common properties of these drugs okay this is common to all your aminoglycoside group of drugs either can be gentamicin amikacin tobramycin these properties are common some of them are these are poorly absorbed from your git it means that you cannot give orally these drugs we give parenteral injections these drugs okay and these drugs have got synergistic action when you combine with beta lactam antibiotics I hope at least some few names you remember what are beta lactam antibiotics last time as we said they are penicillins cephalosporins important these are beta lactam antibiotics so whenever we give these aminoglycoside group of drugs they are combined with beta lactam antibiotics okay these aminoglycosides act on gram negative and beta lactam act on gram positive both have got and these aminoglycosides they show concentration dependent killing it means that these if I'm giving injection like streptomycin I have to give whole dose higher the dose more is the killing of organisms it means it is concentration dependent killing antibiotic effect it means that now once if I given an injection later the concentration of the drug reduces still then its antibacterial activities continued because these are bactericidal drugs so instead of giving small multiple doses we need to give a single large dose so instead of giving gentamicin twice daily give a single whole dose in the one as a single dose if you give they are more effective these drugs have got narrow margin of safety it means that if the dose of the drug is very high it can lead to toxicity like ototoxicity oto means your ears these drugs can cause ototoxicity okay some of these drugs can also cause nephrotoxicity neurotoxicity this is common to all your aminoglycoside group of drugs if any person is having kidney disease the dose has to be adjusted in them because these drugs mainly are excreted unchanged by your kidneys so if any person is having renal problem in them always reduce the dose of aminoglycosides and then give the drugs okay these are the common properties of our aminoglycoside group of drugs next slide the next slide next slide okay now coming to the mechanism of action of these drugs as you see in this diagram see on your right hand side synthesis is occurring. That is a ribosome. Okay, that is your ribosome where protein synthesis is occurring. So your aminoglycosides will go and bind to the 30S subunit. That is down the orange color, whatever you see, the smaller subunit, that is 30S. Aminoglycosides go and bind to the 30S and they inhibit protein synthesis. So you can see in the flow chart, by binding to the 30S ribosomes, okay, your drugs are inhibiting the protein synthesis. They have got bactericide. Next. Okay, the spectrum of these drugs, mainly remember these are narrow spectrum antibiotics. They're mainly active against your gram-negative aerobic bacilli. So you can see in the picture, those are the gram-negative organisms. They are pink color stained. You can see they are rod-shaped, so they are bacilli. If they are round-shaped, they will be cocci. If they are rod-shaped, they are bacillus. Okay. Now, what are these important gram-negative bacillus are? They are Proteus, E. coli, Enterobacter, Klebsiella, Shigella. These are some of the gram-negative aerobic bacilli. Okay. Now, they're also effective against some of the gram-positive cocci like Staph aureus and Streptococcus viridans. But remember, they cannot be active against gram-positive bacilli like your Cornibacterium. They're not effective. Clostridium, they're not effective. Okay. So, importantly, they're active against your gram-negative bacilli organisms. Next slide. Now, coming to the uses of these drugs, you can just see in this picture, always aminoglycosides are used along with a cell wall synthesis inhibitor. It means that we combine aminoglycosides with a penicillin like benzyl penicillin, okay, or ticarcillin penicillin. It can be combined or with a third generation cephalosporine like cefotoxime. It is combined and used. We don't use alone these drugs. So it is used in the management of pneumonias, tuberculosis, okay, variety of gram positive and gram negative infections, and also if you are doing any procedures, either gastrointestinal, any procedures you want to do, we give these aminoglycosides. And the commonly used drug is your gentamicin group of drugs. And sepsis, if any patient is having sepsis or septicemia is there, diabetic ketoacidosis, any of these conditions, severe infection is there, in that condition we give aminoglycosides IV along with a penicillin or cephalosporin group of drug. And topically, these drugs are also used to treat various skin infections. Next. Okay, same thing. I have just mentioned the tablet. For simple bacillary infection, we don't use. Only for severe gram-negative bacillary infections, we use these aminoglycoside group of drugs. It can be septicemia or any pelvic abscess, sepsis, abdominal sepsis, osteomyelitis, all these severe kind of infections which are due to gram-negative organism, then only we use this aminoglycosides. Simple UTI and all we don't use, okay? Only severe infections we use. It can be also bacterial endocarditis, that is infection of your heart valves. There also we use these aminoglycosides, again in combination with the penicillin. Okay, it's also used to management of tuberculosis. Tuberculosis streptomycin is the first line of anti-tubercular drug. Other drug like amikacin we used in resistant tuberculosis. Remember that. Then also streptomycin is combined with tetracycline. We used in the management of plague or brucellosis. Now coming to the topical preparations, neomycin, framacitin. I shall tell about this in the next slide. Next. Okay, coming to gentamicin, this is the most frequently used aminoglycoside group of drug. Again, use, as I mentioned earlier, restricted to severe like septicemia is there, sepsis is there, in that severe pelvic infection, mixed infections are there, bacterial endocarditis is there. We combine these drugs with penicillin, ampicillin or vancomycin, any of these, they combine and give. It can also be used for pseudomonas we combine with picarcilin. It can be also used to treat meningitis. Okay, to treat meningitis due to gram negative bacilli like H influenza, pseudomonas, mycoplasma meningitis. All this you can treat aminoglycoside group of drug. Next. These drugs are ototoxic. They can cause lot of ear damage, either vestibular or cochlear damage. Even in children, amikacin when used, it can cause permanent deafness. Okay, it can lead to permanent deafness. So you should be careful while giving these drugs. These drugs can also cause nephrotoxicity. So if any person already renal compromise is there, the creatinine clearance is reduced in them. In that case, if you need to give these drugs, you have to reduce the dose according to the creatinine clearance and give and increase the duration of dosage. Try to reduce the total duration of treatment in these patients. Otherwise, first of all, this drug is nephrotoxic. It can, as a drug is toxicity by these drugs. In renal failure patients, if possible, try to avoid the drugs. If possible, try to give some other alternatives. Okay. And these drugs can also cause neuromuscular blockade because they prevent release of acetylcholine at your neuromuscular junction. They can also cause neuromuscular blockade. So these are common to all your aminoglycoside group of drugs. Next. Now, precautions what to be taken when you're giving these drugs is do not give these drugs to the pregnant women. If you give during pregnancy, it can lead to it can cause fetal ototoxicity. So do not give in the pregnant mother. And if you do not combine these drugs with other ototoxic drugs like your furosemide, one of the example which is a diuretic, do not combine these drugs. Additive, they can cause ear damage. Or do not combine with your other nephrotoxic drugs. Elderly patients, as I said earlier, depending on the creatinine clearance, you try to give the drugs. You can either reduce the dose and total duration or increase the duration in between treatment. That is, you have to reduce the frequency of administration of these amounts. Okay. If any person you're giving a muscle relaxants, like patient is undergoing surgery, in that case also you should be very cautious in giving. Do not mix these drugs with any other drug in the same syringe. Always we have to use different syringes for two the drug precipitate. Next, coming to neomycin. Okay, it's a very commonly used and topical ointment. You can use in your skin, your eye, and external ear infections. This can be usually neomycin. It will be combined with bacitracin and polymyxin, as I've shown in the picture. You can see those ointments. These are very frequently used for your common infections. Okay, for topical preparations. And also, only oral usage of these aminoglycosides is, as remember, these drugs are not absorbed orally. We just give this neomycin tablets are used for preparation of bubble before your surgery, just for gut sterilization. You're preparing some patient for some gut surgery. So post-operatively, patient will be prone for many of the infections because of the spilling of the contents of your intestine. For that purpose, what we do, previously one day, we give neomycin 1 gram tablets 3 times a day before surgery for gut sterilization. It will prevent the flaring of pathogens. Also, these drugs are used in hepatic coma patients. Just they suppress the production of ammonia in these patients. Okay. So for that, they'll prevent encephalopathy. That is, hepatic encephalopathy will be prevented by decreasing ammonia. This is the reason why we give neomycin orally. Otherwise, rest all preparations, we give injectables, and topical neomycin is available for various topical infections. Next. Okay. Now, aminoglycosides we saw. Next, we'll move on to the macrolide group of drugs. Just there is a mnemonic race. These are your macrolides: roxithromycin, azithromycin, clarithromycin, and erythromycin. Okay, these are your common macrolide antibiotics which we use in practice. I think now you're very well. Many of you must have taken already azithromycin. We use more frequently azithro and roxithromycin in the practice. Next. Coming to the mechanism of action of these drugs. So even these drugs will bind to the 50S. See above, below. In the lower diagram, you can see the mechanism of action. The below one is a 30S, above is a 50S. So this is a ribosome structure where your protein synthesis is occurring. Proteins is made up of your amino acids. Now, what does your macrolide group of antibiotics do is they bind to the 50S and they prevent the growing of the peptide chain. Okay, they prevent the growing of the amino acid. These amino acids attach one by one, so that growing of peptide chain is blocked. So these drugs also inhibit the protein synthesis. Now, what is the mechanism, the spectrum? These drugs are active against gram-positive cocci, that is your streptococcus, and also bacillus like Cornibacterium, diphtheria, clostridium, okay, and also certain organisms like mycoplasma, chlamydia, and legionella. These drugs are active against these organisms. Remember, aminoglycosides are active against gram-negative, whereas your macrolides are mainly effective against your gram-positive cocci and bacillus. Okay, next. Uses of these macrolide group of drugs. Okay, we use it for commonly, we use this drug in the management of diphtheria. You can see in that picture, there will be an oral white patch. That is diphtheria we commonly see in children. But nowadays, it is less because we all are getting immunized against diphtheria. Okay. In any person who is diagnosed with diphtheria, we use is injection erythromycin or also injection penicillin can be used in these patients. Commonly, we used roxithromycin or erythromycin in the management of your respiratory, neonatal, ocular, or genital chlamydial infections. We use macrolides. These are also used to treat community-acquired pneumonia. Commonly, in the practice, we are now giving azithromycin. Okay, 500 milligrams once daily for 3 days, or roxithromycin 150 milligrams twice daily for 5 days. So frequently we use these for your respiratory infections. Okay, if any patient is allergic to the penicillin, so you can substitute in those patients with these macrolide group of drugs for the management of either anthrax, syphilis, gonorrhea, diphtheria, any of these cases you can give macrolides. Also in patients, if a patient is having valvular heart disease, if he has to undergo dental procedure, we give them prophylactic antibiotics. So in that patients also, you can give azithromycin. Next. Okay, I'm not going to detail. So just I have mentioned what are the various dosage of these drugs, how many days needs to be given. You can just see there are also liquid preparations available, tablets are available. So we use roxithromycin and azithromycin in children as well. Okay, these are the commonly used preparations. Next, azithromycin, I'll try to focus on this because we commonly use this drug. What are the advantages of azithromycin over your erythromycin? Okay, the advantage, expanded spectrum. Now, whatever spectrum we saw for erythromycin, along with that, azithromycin inhibits Mycobacterium avium complex and H influenza. So it is more effective against your respiratory infections. The spectrum extends to H influenza organism, which most H influenza causes respiratory infections. So it's effective against that. Better gastric tolerance. Erythromycin can cause a lot of gastritis. It can cause diarrhea, but that is less frequently seen with your azithromycin. Rapid oral, all have experienced. It's a once a day dosing. Means today if I'm taking 10 o'clock azithromycin, tomorrow I need to take at 10 o'clock. So once a day dosing. That's how the patient is happy with your azithromycin once a day dosing. It has got marked tissue distribution. Even the intracellular organisms are killed by this. It's highly efficacious, good acid stability. It means that the azithromycin is not destroyed by your gastric juice. Okay, it has got a high bioavailability compared to your erythromycin, and it doesn't have any drug interactions. Whereas your erythromycin, being an enzyme inhibitor, it causes lot of drug interactions. But remember, all these macrolides, importantly azithromycin and even roxithromycin, if you're taking, take 1 hour before or 2 hours after meals. Now, why is it so? Because your food interferes with their absorption and decrease their bioavailability. If you're taking azithromycin, take 1 hour before food. Okay, or what you do is you finish your breakfast. After 2 hours, you can take azithromycin, and every day take at the same time. Do not change your timings. Okay, that depends all on their half-life. So always advise, even if patient is taking roxithromycin, advise them to take 30 minutes before the meals. Next. Next. Okay. Uses of azithromycin. Okay, it's used in the management of Legionnaires' pneumonia and also sexually transmitted infections like chancroid. We use in STDs like chancroid, lymphogranuloma venereum, donovanosis. All these are STD infections, sexually transmitted infections. There also we use azithromycin. Okay, if frequently nowadays we use for URI is upper respiratory infection, lower respiratory infections, sinusitis, otitis media. In all this, we use this azithromycin. And also we use to treat Mycobacterium avium complex infections. In case of AIDS patient, we use important use of these drugs is we also use azithromycin to treat pelvic inflammatory diseases and bacterial vaginosis in female patients. Okay, that I have mentioned over the picture over there. It's a combination of three drugs: fluconazole, azithromycin, and ceftriaxone. Next slide.
Madam, is there no day?
Ha, sir. Nandrali, please check your internet connection and bartha ide sir. Adukku wait martha ide.
Okay, madam. Azithromycin for COVID-19 and bandidru.
For COVID-19?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. The regime what we are now, I think everybody is well versed with COVID-19. We are using tablet hydroxychloroquine, okay, 600 milligrams per day for 10 days, and tablet azithromycin, that is 500 milligrams on day one, followed by okay, we use azithromycin in combination with hydroxychloroquine. There are already many studies have been published on this. Can just check the internet for various studies. They have shown that both have got synergistic activity and they're helping in decreasing the viral load in the patient and helping in the prognosis of the patients. Next. Side effect.
Next slide, I don't know.
Sir Nandroli, please check your internet and the block activity, sir.
Next slide, I didn't know. Macrolides side effects something.
These are all common with your erythromycin. Comparatively, your new drugs are quite safe. They can cause ototoxic. These drugs can be ototoxic. These drugs can cause jaundice, and erythromycin causes diarrhea. They can also cause skin rash. But your new drugs are quite Next slide. Okay, coming to the next class of drugs, broad spectrum antibiotics, tetracycline and next slide. These are your tetracyclines. The older tetracyclines are your tetracycline, oxytetracycline and demiclocycline. These are less potent. They are mainly excreted through the kidneys. Okay. Nowadays, what we use frequently is your doxycycline, minocycline. These are longer acting. They are excreted mainly through the liver. That's the advantage that if any patient is having renal diseases, in them you can choose doxycycline and minocycline. They are highly potent drugs. These are your tetracyclines. So what we use nowadays is your mino and doxycycline. Next slide. Okay, these are primarily bacteria again binding to the 30S ribosomes. Now these are broad spectrum antibiotics. They are effective against all kind of organism except your virus and fungi. All gram positive negative bacteria are inhibited by this. Along with that, they also inhibit rickettsia, chlamydia, spirochetes, mycoplasma, actinomycetes and entamoeba histolytica. These are the additional intracellular pathogens against which your tetracyclines are acting. So these, but nowadays there is lot of antimicrobial resistance is seen against your tetracyclines. So they are less favored compared to your new drugs, your cephalosporins. Next. Kinetics, remember, doxy and minocycline is 100%. These tetracyclines should not be given with milk, iron preparations, zinc or antacid, because the tetracyclines chelate all these ions and the absorption will be inhibited. So do not give intramuscular injection these preparations. If you want to give parenteral, give doxycycline IV. Otherwise, no of these drugs are given IM. And do not give these drugs during pregnancy because they are teratogenic. It will affect the baby's growth. Do not give. Adverse effects. Gastrointestinal irritation. They can also get deposited in the bone and the teeth. They can also cause mainly jaundice is seen. Super infections, because these are broad spectrum antibiotics, they can cause super infection. It means that they are given drug to treat one infection, but the patient comes with second infection. Those are called as super infection because it disturbs our normal flora. See your teeth. The teeth and bones get brownish discoloration because it chelates calcium and the phosphate in the teeth. It can lead to phototoxicity. They are teratogenic. Do not give during pregnancy. Next. Now, what are the uses? Empirical therapy means it covers broad range of organisms from gram positive to gram negative. Tetracycline are used as a first choice drugs in plague. Cholera. See, in cholera, you can just give one dose of doxycycline, 200 milligram single dose is sufficient. Earlier, we were giving tetracycline tablets, 2 grams single dose. It can also be used to treat STDs like urethritis, lymphogranuloma venereum, granuloma inguinal. So these can be treated with your tetracyclines. The primary use drugs are your macrolide group of drugs. You can also use to treat brucellosis and rickettsial infection. These are the first choice of drug in all these clinical conditions. Next. Next slide. Okay, these importantly we use in the management of gastric or duodenal infection. Okay, and can also be used to treat gonorrhea, syphilis, actinomycosis, anthrax if any patient is allergic to penicillin. Important use, you can see there, acne. Nowadays, some patients are having severe acne. In that case, you can give capsule doxycycline, 100 milligrams twice daily for 7 to 10 days can be given. Along with that, clindamycin topical application is given to treat acne. Next slide. I'll not go into detail of chloramphenicol because we don't use very frequently. It's also, the spectrum is similar as a tetracycline. Additionally, it covers anaerobic. Chloramphenicol is, it inhibits anaerobic organisms. Mechanism of action, it binds to the 50S and inhibits protein synthesis. This chloramphenicol is a bacteriostatic drug. Next. Uses, earlier we were using chloramphenicol to treat enteric fever, that is a typhoid. Because of the resistance, we don't use chloramphenicol frequently now. Okay, chloramphenicol can also be used to treat anaerobic infections. Earlier also I mentioned this is an important property, is you can give this drug to treat anaerobic infections. The other drugs which we give for anaerobic is your metronidazole, clindamycin, your third generation cephalosporins, quinolones like ciprofloxacin. They can be used to treat anaerobic infections. Brain abscess due to anaerobes can also be treated with chloramphenicol. Remember, if you do not give in pregnant women and newborns. Okay. It causes, it's a teratogenic drug. Do not give in them. Next slide. Others, till now we have done aminoglycoside group of drugs. Then we did macrolides. Then we did tetracyclines. And then a little bit about chloramphenicol. Okay. Lastly, we'll see some other drugs like linezolid and clindamycin. These drugs also inhibit protein synthesis. First, only I've mentioned what are the important functions of protein in our body. So they're quite, the meaning of protein is promos, meaning primary. Okay, it's a very important part of a body. These drugs, linezolid, should be used as a reserve drug. It should be used as a reserve drug to treat severe infection, resistant infections. Do not use them as first line or second line of drug. Only in resistant cases we use this. Resistant staph aureus infection, resistant enterococcus infections, multi-drug resistant tuberculosis, okay, community acquired pneumonia. In that cases we use linezolid. For simple infections, do not use this. Always preserve our higher antibiotics. Now coming to clindamycin. Clindamycin is used to treat anaerobic infections, the other use of this drug. Along with that, I have mentioned you earlier, it's also used to treat acne, the topical preparations. Next. Okay. Now considering what are antibiotics safe in pregnancy, which you have to avoid, this slide gives it. Avoid sulfonamides, cotrimoxazole, aminoglycosides, quinolones, tetracyclines, given to the pregnant mother. These drugs are given, not given to the pregnant mother. Next. Now we have, what are the reasons for failure of our antimicrobial therapies? You have wrongly chosen the drug, the dose, duration, all the, there is improper selection. Or you have forgotten to take adjuvant measures, like if there is an abscess, always drain the abscess or remove the foreign body. If needed, do the surgery. and then give the antibiotics. Then they will work more better. Otherwise, there will be failure of your treatment. Or if the patient is having some immunocompromised status, poor host defense, or the organisms are behind the barriers like your subacute bacterial endocarditis. Okay, in them also, it's very difficult to treat infections, like viral infections. In simple viral infections, do not these drugs should not be given to treat viral infections. Or some organisms, they are dormant, means they're not multiplying, but they're just residing in your, like in case of vivax malaria, do not give antibiotics there because the organism is dormant. It's not multiplying. Next. Now, antimicrobial resistance. Okay. Now, these are the commonly used and misused. For simple infections, we try to take antibiotics that is leading to development of antimicrobial resistance. So, how much ever we have antibiotics, they are less nowadays. Always there is a need for increasing new drugs for the practice. So it's a very much global concern, that is antimicrobial resistance. Next. Now, what are the various mechanisms, how the bacteria is developing resistance is? You can see one by one. The first one shows above there, decreased permeability. It means that your bacteria is becoming very much intelligent. It prevents the entry of drug into the cell. So there is decrease in the, importantly, a chloroquine, important anti-malarial drug chloroquine, there is resistance because there is decrease in the permeability of the chloroquine. The next is altered target site. With the penicillins, there is penicillin binding proteins. This I have told about this in the last class. So there is alteration in the structure. So your drug cannot go and bind there to bring about action. The third way may be enzyme inactivation. Your bacteria are producing enzymes like beta-lactamases, penicillase enzyme, they are destroying your drug. So they produce enzymes. The next mechanism, your antibiotics will bypass. Normally they will require the, they synthesize their folic acid own. Now they start using some other bypass way where they will use already formed folic acid. So by this mechanism, they can cause drug resistance. Okay, next. Now, how to prevent drug resistance is, see, all these 12 steps have been mentioned over here. First is always try to prevent infection. Give vaccination whenever required. And catheters, if you have put catheters, you take it out. Okay, you frequently change the catheter with all aseptic preparations. Diagnose and treat effectively. Do not arbitrarily give any drug. Try to give first narrow spectrum drug. If required, then go for broad spectrum antibiotics and treat effectively. Use them wisely. Do not at first place only go for vancomycin, linezolid. All these are higher. Okay, all these are your higher end antibiotic. Go for simple, like your first or second generation cephalosporins, or simple use amoxicillin, or you can also go for quinolones like ciprofloxacin, ofloxacin. Use the simple drugs. Don't go for higher antibiotics at first place. That will lead to a lot of transmission. It means that you prevent contamination, the catheters, whatever you're disposing, that can transmit infection from one person to the another. So you always try to isolate the pathogen so that you can contain it, so that you prevent transmission. So these are steps taken to prevent antimicrobial resistance in hospitalized patients. Next. Next slide. And the next slide. Okay. And the last slide just says that you have to educate the consumers, like there should be no self-medication. Do not take your antibiotics on your own. Okay, always you should emphasize on the dose and duration of the treatment. And ultimately, the last message from the topic is always take as directed, take full prescription. Don't stop antibiotics taking for 2 days. If they're given amoxicillin for 3 times daily for 5 days, take daily 3 doses. If you take one dose for once daily, it is not sufficient. So always follow the full prescription, even if you're feeling better. Okay. And also this will help to prevent your antibiotic resistance. Okay. This completes our topic on antimicrobial drugs, part one and part two. The slides are provided to you all. Along with, I have mentioned some of the links that will also be shared to you all. You can just see how antimicrobial resistance occurs. And also you can check how to prevent antimicrobial resistance. Okay. Sorry for all the interruption, children, here, whatever has happened. Hello. Is it okay?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you for your patient listening. If any problem is there, you can just ask me in the next class. Okay, thank you, students.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Thank you for helping me to share the slides, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.